We're high in the mountains of Southern Colorado in Pagosa Springs, and we're just about ready to go meet Wayne and Cathy Justus, who learned the hard way just how devastating fluoride can be to their animals. They show horses, quarter horses. They've lost 6 and 4 dogs. They now know why.
Where we're overlooking now is the overlook from Wolf Creek Pass on the western slope of the Continental Divide. And what you're seeing down below is the San Juan River running through the pristine valley, heading to Pagosa Springs about 10 miles away. This is Treasure Falls. This is one of the sources of the San Juan River. You can see how it's pretty pristine. Where this water comes from. The water that comes through Pagosa Springs, we are the first town on this water source. We are at the source of the water that heads toward California. This is Pagosa Springs, from which Pagosa Springs gets its name from. It's supposed to be the hottest, deepest springs in the world. Ironically, Pagosa Springs means healing water. Okay, we live upwind, and there are no fumes that come down on our place from the springs. We live quite a ways from the springs, so as the crow flies, there's not any sediment coming out of the springs or the steam or anything on our place.
She won't catch a ball or a frisbee. It's got to be a fun.
This is the hay that we have left over from last year. We're soon to be getting third cutting of the new cutting 2006 hay to be delivered and put up in the barn. For we always get a year's worth at a time, and the barn will be totally full when that comes. We'll feed everything by weight. Each horse gets an individual ration. I feed my animals a custom mix that I mix myself. It's all organic. Individual things that I know exactly what each horse is getting. 10, 12, 15 different kinds of herbs in it. No pesticides, no fluoride. This is organic garlic powder. This is organic flaxseed. This is the same bee pollen that we eat. Her, she hadn't been messed with at all, and she was absolutely scared of everybody and everything. When I started brushing her, I was like, ooh, that's nice. I like that. She was grand champion mare under both judges at the Palomino show at the Colorado State Fair. She already has registered merits. Hi, I'm Cathy Justus. My husband is Wayne Justus, Western artist. We raise registered quarter horses. We breed, show, and play with our horses. We love our horses. And everything was going great until 1985, when artificial fluoridation started. We had no idea that was what was making our horses sick. So we changed feeds. We did everything. Had vets come out. We went to the ends of the earth trying to figure out what was wrong with our horses. And it wasn't until
My most precious baby doe died. It's hard to talk about it. Anyway, we sent her leg. When she died, we had taken her to six different vets, two of which were at Colorado State University, that had absolutely no clue what was wrong with her. After she died, we asked the vet to do an autopsy, and the vet thought that possibly there were other things that had killed her. She had so many varied symptoms, neurological problems, Cushing's disease, lameness, thyroid problems, breathing problems. The list just goes on and on, reproductive problems. And so the vet said that she thought that possibly some of the symptoms could have been pointed to particular things, West Nile, botulism, EPM, different things. And so we told the vet to test her for anything and everything that she could think of that could have caused her problems, because we wanted a definitive answer as to what killed her. But I specifically told her I wanted her checked for chronic fluoride poisoning, which at that time was still my theory that was what was bothering her, was making her sick. Anyway, the vet took heart, lung, liver, kidney, all kinds of parts and sent them off, and every one of them came back negative. We went ahead and buried the mare without a definitive answer of what killed her. So I got on the phone, was able to contact Dr. Lennart Krook, professor of pathology emeritus at Cornell University, who has spent his life diagnosing chronic fluoride poisoning, mostly in cattle, and told him what the symptoms were. And he said, well, I need a leg. He wanted to know if the vet had taken any bone specimens, and I said no. And he said, well, that's the only way that we can make a positive diagnosis. So my husband dug the mare back up, took a leg just below the knee, and sent it to Dr. Krook.
Started by examining one selected bone submitted for examination. We did chemical analysis of the bone ash. We took radiographs, and we took samples for microscopic examination. The changes in the radiographs and those under the microscopes are typical, not to say pathognomonic, of fluoride poisoning. So in the first report on that single case only, I concluded, quote, with reasonable scientific probability, unquote, that the changes here indicates that the horse was suffering from chronic fluoride poisoning.
And after about a month, we received a 17-page report with the final conclusion of chronic fluoride poisoning. A friend of ours, who had a horse, a gelding, that had similar symptoms, obviously not the reproductive problems, but the Cushing's disease, the breathing problems, skin problems, different things. And that horse got so bad that they put him down. And so we took a leg, one of his legs, and sent to Cornell. And his report also came back with chronic fluoride poisoning. There was a third horse, also not my horse, that had died. The owner said that the horse had had chronic back problems ever since they had moved to Pagosa Springs and had no clue why it had had back problems. And so we took its leg when it was put down and sent, and it also came back with the same diagnosis. In 2005, we had another mare. When she finally died, we sent her bone, and it came back with the same conclusion.
My horse that I call Skipper, right from the get-go when he was born, and he's second generation, started out with an attitude, and he'd try to bite me anytime I went by, and he even kicked me one time, and to the point where at one time I even thought of getting rid of him and getting another horse. This was all while he was on fluoridated water. We noticed it didn't take too long after fluoridation had quit in our water that his attitude changed, and he now is a lover. He's a completely different horse. So I wouldn't sell him or part with him for $1 million. No, he's a great horse. This also happened with one other horse that we have that has a completely different breeding. So we know it's not the breeding that's caused it. And she used to would bite you anytime you'd walk by her stall. And now she's the same way. She's a lover. And I've been around horses all my life. And so I know it wasn't from the way I was treating him or trying to deal with him, the reason that he had that attitude. It had to have been the fluoridation.
Winter of 2003-2004, we had snow on the ground all winter long. That's the first winter in many winters, because Colorado's been having a drought, that we had snow on the ground all winter long. We have a 100-gallon tank outside, and we do allow our horses to be horses, so we keep them in the barn at night, but during the day, which is the biggest part of their day, they are out and they're able to play and do what they like to do. Well, we noticed that that tank that we normally filled every day to day and a half was only needing filled every 18 to 19 days. So we started watching the horses, and they would even stand right there by the tank with the heated city fluoridated water, looked clean, and eat snow. And they were eating snow a big part of the day. And we noticed that all the colic stopped. The amount of colics that we were having, we didn't have one colic all winter long. And almost all of the symptoms, we had Baby Doe, who had all this heavy Cushing's hair, she shed all winter long. Well, when it gets down to 35 degrees below zero, a horse shouldn't be shedding, but she was shedding this excess hair. Anyway, after all the snow melted, we have a little ravine that runs through our place, and there was still snow up on the hill under the trees. And this little, you can't even call it a stream, is about 6 inches wide and maybe an inch deep of water, muddy water, was coming down the hill. And the horses would go over there and dig a little pool of this dirty, thick, muddy water, and would rather drink that water rather than drink the so-called clean city water. After that all dried up, we got our first colic again when they had to start drinking only city water. So we did a major search again. We'd been searching for years, finally found someone who would allow us to use their water rights out of the San Juan River to haul water. And we bought a big 325 or 50 gallon tank that we put in the back of our truck and started hauling water for our horses. Since then, that was in March of 2004, we have not had another colic, and every symptom has abated since then, other than Baby Doe and the other mare Bird that died, that were just too far gone. They were so far gone, had too much accumulation in their body to come out of it. Horses, on average, a standing horse, one that is not doing anything, will drink between 10 to 12 gallons a day. A lactating mare can actually double that amount. Ironic thing is, the horses that we had get the sickest the quickest were the mares that were lactating, the mares that we had for brood mares. And you see here, this is Baby Doe, the first horse that Dr. Krook diagnosed. Her hooves were getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and this was the spring of 2004 after having snow on the ground. And you can see her hoof was growing back to normal. This was the abnormal part. I was making a list of things that were manifesting in our horses. So I'm going to read it here. Of course, the colics, head shaking, muscle twitching, spasms, seizures, falling for no reason, jerking, eventually complete loss of neurological response, skeletal problems, bony deposits on bones, cracking and popping with every move, hoof deformities, lameness, legs on grown horses becoming bowed and crooked, swelling joints, tendons and ligaments hardening, laminitis, and he brought up the point that there are so many animals, horses these days, being afflicted with laminitis for not any real apparent reason, that fluoride might be a problem with this epidemic. Choppy, stiff gaits, joints giving way, ribs becoming fused so breathing was difficult, thinness, abscesses, slobbering, thyroid problems, reproductive problems, excessive sweating, abortions, sterility, cryptorchids, constant milk production, even in mares that had never been bred, uterine discharges and infections. We had one mare that went from a regular infection to E. coli to staph infection that could not be controlled, lack of heat cycles, small and dismature foals born with crooked legs, Cushing's disease and equine metabolic syndrome. I had one lady call me from town that said she personally, without looking, knew of 15 horses that had Cushing's disease. Not shedding coats with very long coats, horses that were very lethargic, loss of muscle tone and mass, dips over eyes would fill in and stick out a lot of times beyond the eyeballs, lameness, and dental fluorosis, and then the attitude problems that Wayne was talking about, chronic coughing and wheezing, allergic reaction with skin bumps, kidney problems, constant excessive urination, and cancer.
To summarize what we found in the Justus horses, one, there is a source of fluoride, namely the artificial fluoridation of the community water, which is the only source of water for the horses and the only source of fluoride, because there is no fluoridated mineral supplements used, and there is no fluoride-containing fertilizer used on the farm. Two, dental fluorosis. Three, we have the clinical manifestations as documented by Cathy Justus there in numerous pictures. Hoof deformities, thickened bones. Then we have chemical analysis of the bone ash from a number of horses. We have radiographic evidences. Now we are up to 3, 4, 5. We have also microscopic evidences of fluoride damage to the bone tissue, also reported allergy reaction to the artificial fluoridation of the community water. So all with the evidences we have accumulated, there can be no doubt at all, and stated with reasonable scientific certainty, that the Justus horses were and are suffering from chronic fluoride poisoning.
He took what he received, the information that he received from Baby Doe, my mare, Riley, the friend's horse, and the third horse, and wrote a peer-reviewed article that has now been published in the January-March issue, 2006 issue, of Fluoride, the quarterly journal of the International Society for Fluoride Research. After that was written and published, there was so much worldwide response from that and request for a follow-up for more symptoms that my horses showed, that a second article has now been written and peer-reviewed and published in the April-June issue, 2006 issue of the same periodical called Fluoride. It wasn't until we got the scientific paper from Dr. Krook, the first one from Baby Doe, that I sent the water department a letter and told them, this is what you've done to my horses. And they were totally appalled. I've been the crazy blonde woman for years. And so they asked me to come and speak to one of their board meetings and actually let me speak for over an hour. And being that they had never even called me to ask, to say, you know, gee, what's going on out there? Why do you suspect the fluoridated water? They got an earful when they heard the stories, the horror stories, when they saw the pictures that we had of our horses through the years that they had totally ignored. After that first meeting, we had, I believe, another couple meetings, meeting or two with the board. Second meeting, they were going to educate us how good fluoride was for us. And of course, the things that they said were basically lies. They were had believed the things that they had been told by the so-called experts, and they decided that they were going to have a countywide forum to figure out what the general populace thought. Well, a lot of people in Pagosa Springs had educated themselves. We overfilled the room. There wasn't even standing room. I mean, it was, they were out in the halls wanting to get into this. They had their so-called three experts, the state epidemiologist and head of the public health department, and their state, the state fluoride expert and a local dentist. And I was warned five different times before, the week before the forum, that there will be no debating. Absolutely no debating. And I had read for years that the so-called experts will not debate because they cannot debate. What they are saying is not true. Anyway, we got there and we presented our side. They presented their side first. We presented our side. We also showed a tape of Dr. Hersey doing his Senate subcommittee testimony.
Thank you for the opportunity to appear today to present the views of the union on the issue of fluoridation of public water supplies. Our union represents the staff, scientists, lawyers, and others who analyze hazard exposure and economic data and advise management how to use them in public health protection. I'm not here today to speak for EPA, but rather the union, founded 17 years ago to protect EPA workers from unethical pressure by EPA managers. It was on that basis in 1985 that we first got involved in this issue. In 1997, we voted to oppose fluoridation, and our opposition has grown stronger as more adverse data on the practice has come in. In the interest of time, let me state our recommendations first. We ask that you order an independent review of the cancer bioassay of sodium fluoride mandated in 1977 by Congress. Evidence for carcinogenicity in that assay was systematically downgraded by a special executive branch commission appointed and run by the very agencies that Congress did not trust to run the bioassay in the first place. That action saved fluoridation temporarily. We ask that you order chronic toxicity studies on the two waste products that are now used in 90% of fluoridation programs. EPA says there are at present no chronic toxicity data on them, and we ask that you order EPA set an MCL for fluoride that's truly protective of all American citizens, infants and adults alike, because the current one does not, in violation of the Safe Drinking Water Act. We ask that you order epidemiology studies using dental fluorosis as an index of exposure to determine the extent of other toxic effects, especially effects on the brain and bone in the population that are attributable to fluoride. We ask that you convene a joint congressional committee to give this issue the full airing that it deserves. It's been 23 years since the last one, and it's high time for a new one. I offer the following in support of these recommendations. The American people, and especially our children, are getting way too much fluoride. Two-thirds of children living in fluoridated communities have dental fluorosis in at least one tooth. Dental fluorosis is the visible manifestation of toxic overexposure to fluoride during their developmental years. The initial findings of the cancer bioassay were for clear evidence of carcinogenicity, and that is consistent with several epidemiology and many mutagenesis studies. The protected pollutant status that fluoride enjoys within EPA and other federal establishments is remarkable, as the charts over here show. EPA stated regarding the chemical used in 90% of fluoridated communities that, quote, by recovering fluosilicic acid from fertilizer manufacturing, water and air pollution are minimized, and water authorities have a low cost of fluoride. In other words, EPA's solution to pollution by this waste product is dilution, as long as it's not dumped into rivers and lakes, but rather directly into drinking water systems. Congressman Calvert of the House Science Committee has letters of inquiry out to EPA and other federal entities on this subject. The 1983 report of a Surgeon General's panel on fluoride to EPA was altered without consultation or notification of the panel members, so as to help EPA justify an outrageous set of drinking water standards promulgated in 1986. The results of a 50-year experiment conducted in Kingston and Newburgh, New York, show that there's no overall difference in dental caries rates between the two communities, but there's a significantly higher incidence of dental fluorosis in the fluoridated community. Since 1994, there have been six studies that show adverse effects of fluoride on the brain, even at the so-called optimum level of one part per million. The epidemiology studies that we recommend above should make a prime effort to look at brain effects, given the national concern over attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder and autism in our children. Three trial judges since 1978 made findings of fact that water fluoridation poses an unreasonable risk to the American people. Fluoridation proponents like to say that there's no real controversy about fluoridation, and they're right. When these three disinterested trial judges heard weeks of testimony, they came to the same conclusion that our union did about the unreasonable risks involved. The findings of fact remain untouched in those trials today. Recent publications indicate a link between the use of silico fluorides for fluoridation and elevated blood lead levels in children and antisocial behavior. And leading dental researchers are changing their views on the safety and efficacy of fluoridation. Doctors John Calhoun and Hardy Lineback, both former spokespersons for fluoridation, have published recantations of their former position. On behalf of EPA's professional community, I urge the subcommittee to convene a select committee for a national review of water fluoridation. It's high time we do that, and I'd be happy to take questions.
And the moans and groans while we were showing that tape was really great. Anyway, the audience pretty much chewed up the so-called experts. They put them in their place, and it was that was, I believe, March 8th of 2005, March 30th of 2005, all the equipment that was disconnected. We have no more fluoridation in Pagosa. I distill all of our drinking water, our dog's water now. We've had four dogs die, so we've now decided to give our dogs only distilled water also, and Wayne and I only drink distilled water. This is what we got out of the distiller while the water was fluoridated. This is what we got out of it 1 month later after the fluoridation stopped. You see there's still white stuff in the bottom. This was 8:05. What we were getting out. And then this is 11:05, and that's that brown solid stuff in there is just the buildup of sediments. But you see how much clearer it got, and it wasn't thick. And my horses have gotten well, continuously improving in leaps and bounds. It's like my husband says, it's like being on vacation, not having to worry about horses getting colic, horses being lame, horses having all these diverse problems.
The fluoridation of the Pagosa area water supply ceased. The citizens stood up and demanded that the water district act responsibly, and thankfully they did. Today in the United States, over 200 million people are still being subjected to this costly and health-damaging experiment. In a democracy, it's the responsibility of the citizens to make sure that our elected officials act with due diligence, ethically, and responsibly. So it's now your job to make the public water supply safe for us all to drink, free from industrial contamination and adulteration with hazardous waste byproducts that have never been approved for human consumption. On a sadder note, January 31st, Wayne's horse, the big dun called Skipper, died of lung cancer, a predictable outcome.
Well, we haven't lost any more dogs. The dogs that we have now have never drank any fluoridated water. They've just drank distilled water that we have distilled ourselves. And the oldest dog that we have is now 11. So she was born during fluoridation, but she never drank any of that fluoridated water. She is extremely healthy. In fact, she got kicked by a horse last year, and we took her to the vet. And the vet checked her all over and was totally amazed at the condition of this dog compared to every other dog that we had had previous that had consumed the fluoridated water.
And you had how many dogs that were affected by fluoridation?
Four dogs, eight horses. Skipper, who was in the very end of the DVD, he died just before the DVD was released. We paid for another necropsy. There were two surgeons and a pathologist that did the necropsy, and they said that his lungs had huge cancerous tumors in there, One had eaten through an artery, which is where all the blood was coming from, and his kidneys were completely full of cancer. He was not quite 9 years old, technically nine, but he died January 31st of 2008. His full brother, who was born in 1998, died this past year of a massive heart attack. Both of these geldings were second generation consuming fluoridated water. Both of them were born sick. Both of them had multiple problems. They had improved in some of the problems, but other problems didn't improve. Well, we have two left that consume fluoridated water. One is the red, the sorrel mare that had the real strange looking bumps. She was only on the fluoridated water for 18 months. We thought that she was improving. We have bred her now three times to two different stallions. She's conceived all three times, but by the time we have another ultrasound at 60 days, she's aborted. So she is not able to hold a baby yet. So we're still hoping and praying that sooner or later we'll be able to get her in foal and she'll be able to carry the foal. Another gelding who was born in 1986, the year after fluoridation started, his whole adult life he's had chronic coughs. That went away within a year of stopping the fluoridation. So did the cough of this sorrel mare. Her coughs went away. He's never been quite there. He's never been real smart. He's just like he's in, like a zombie in La La Land. Last fall, we started noticing that he was getting smarter. The one he had, I would say, was real similar to Alzheimer's. He just wasn't all there. And since last fall, his brain has been coming back around. He got so bad that he couldn't even remember where he ate every day. You'd have to take him and show him where to eat. When you'd take him out in the pasture, he'd stand there like, what am I supposed to do? In 2004, we purchased a filly that was 5.5 months old from a non-fluoridated area in Utah. She has eaten the same food, you know, drank the non-fluoridated river water for the time that we were hauling that, and then fluoridation stopped. She has not manifested one single problem at all. And she's eating the same thing as all the other horses did through all that time. In 2008, we purchased a 7-year-old gelding, and he has not tested a single problem that every other horse that we either purchased or was born here had manifested during fluoridation.
So everything's back to normal on the farm?
Back to normal. In fact, Dr. Krook called this filly that we bought in 2004. He said, that's our control.